How you doing, guys? Welcome back to another video. This is the first in the series interviewing healthcare professionals, students, and people just associated with the healthcare system. To anyone thinking about graduate medicine or the wider fields working in the healthcare system, hopefully these videos will be helpful in understanding other people's journeys and perspectives. Today, I am interviewing Harry Swift. He is a respiratory physiologist working with the NHS in the UK. He's a good friend of mine from Southampton, and I'm really looking forward to speaking with him. As I make this video, we are nearing 50 subscribers. It would mean a huge amount for anyone watching. If you haven't already subscribed, please do subscribe. It means a lot. Also, in the course of this conversation, me and Harry had a discussion about his mug. He claims it was orange. I'm sure it was yellow. Please, can we confirm this in the comments? It's yellow. Just a side note, some of us do refer to Harry as Chunks, and so you will hear me calling him by that name in the course of this video, just for any confusion. The timestamps for what we talked about will be down in the description of the video, so if you want to skip to something specific, feel free to do that. There are a couple of bloopers at the end. Let me know what you think. Were they Harry's fault or were they mine? Who knows? There were definitely his. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoy this one and see you guys again soon.
So before we begin, what have we got in the mug? What's going on?
I got tea.
You got tea? Oh, really? Okay.
For a 21-year-old, definitely 21.
nice tea.
21.
Yeah. But more importantly, what is it? PG tips or something?
Yorkshire tea.
Yorkshire tea, okay, of course.
Yorkshire tea, yeah. It's the only way to go.
My God, okay, that's what you get in the UK. Yeah, obviously, mine is not. Mine is one of my favourite mugs, the Scrabble mug, and it is...
I think the fact that your favourite mug is a Scrabble mug just speaks volumes.
Sorry, I should clarify. Did I say favourite mug? I meant second favourite mug, because I said on a previous video, I said on my results video that my... Dunkin' Donuts. I think I might have said it was my favorite mug, or I said one of. But I think that probably is my favorite mug.
You're lying to all your viewers, is what you're telling us.
Exactly. Yeah. So I'll rephrase and say one of my favorite mugs, but maybe comes in second place. So people know you're a respiratory physiologist.
Yes.
And they know you're from the UK. But tell us a bit about yourself. How have you gotten to here? What's happened?
So my journey into the healthcare system is a very, very odd one. I'm very happy that I'm here. I've really landed on my feet. I've got very, very lucky with where I am at the moment. But my background, my degree is actually in psychology. Mainly because I wasn't really 100% sure what I wanted to study at A-levels. I don't know. It's college where you're from.
It's a leaving cert over here, yeah.
Yeah, there you go. I wasn't 100% sure what I wanted to do with anything, really. I was interested in psychology, absolutely loved it. So I thought, you know what, I'm going to try and do an undergrad in clinical and health psychology is the actual title. Did my 3 years, got my degree, left uni, and I was still in the sort of the same position, really. Didn't know what I wanted to do. I was at camp with yourself and some other friends, which I did for a few years after uni as well, just because, again, I was really enjoying it. I didn't want to give that part of my life up, I suppose. Then it sort of got to the point where, how old was I? I must have been 23, 24 at this point. Started to think, now's the sort of time where I sort of need to start thinking about a career, that sort of conversation with myself, really. And one of my very good friends, that I studied psychology with, said there might be an opening to be a respiratory physiologist down in Southampton, where he was currently working, I should say. And I had a little bit of a look into it. I'd thought a lot about the health service, but I had a look at the job. I had a look at what I'd be doing, the different tests that I'd be doing, my day-to-day roles, and thought, you know what, this actually sounds really interesting, and I've got nothing else to do right now, so I might as well just go for it. It's just one of those things that you got to do, really. Like, if I hate it, I hate it. If I love it, I love it. Yeah. And I got really, really lucky. I got to the job. I found it really interesting, just learning not only about, obviously, mainly the respiratory system, but also how that interacts with other parts of the body, and then also on a more day-to-day basis, just the inner workings of the hospital that I find really interesting as well, and what's going on the wards, what's going on with the outpatients. And I just really got myself stuck in, and that's how I ended up where I am now.
As you know,
I've got myself a new job moving on from Southampton. I've been Southampton for about a year now over a small pandemic. But that's where I am at the moment, and that's what's going on for me, really.
Fantastic. And it's funny, so because you said clinical psychology, so I mean, you must feel like some of the skills from your undergraduate maybe paid dividends when you were in respiratory physiology, or not really?
Not really, no. So clinical psychology, my interest in clinical psychology mainly stemmed from the diagnosis and the treatment of mental illnesses, which is what I find really interesting. And of course, the brain, but that's where my interest in psychology lay, really, just interactions with the world and people's interactions with the world, and how they can sometimes be changed, or they can be different from one person to the next. Like a very interesting question I was posed at A level was, how do you know that the colors that we see are exactly the same color? You see it in the same shade, if you get what I mean.
Right.
So whereas we can all look at this and say that's orange, but are we seeing the actual same color?
No, because I'm seeing yellow. maybe it's the laptop. Maybe
definitely orange. But
really,
yeah, it's 100% orange. It's
right. Well,
does that look more orange now?
We'll agree to disagree, shall we?
She's orange. She's orange. Oh my god. But the point I'm getting at,
actually, that's a great, there's a question right in the comments. Anyone that's watching this video, that is still watching this video after this conversation, is this yellow or orange? Please,
it's orange. That is orange right there.
That is orange. That is yellow all day.
I don't know what laptop screen you're using. I don't know what eyeball you're using. But the point I'm getting at is just the differences of each and every individual. And it's very difficult to, well, it's pretty much impossible to say that one person is the same as another. And that's where my interest in psychology lay. But if you want, at that point in my life, if you wanted to go further into psychology, you need a master's at the very least. Potentially a PhD.
Yes.
To be able to really stand out whilst applying for jobs in psychology. And at that point in my life, I just wasn't ready to commit to that sort of education.
Right. So here you are, a spiritual physiologist.
Yeah.
What, for many of us, you know, there are so many roles in the healthcare system that we haven't been exposed to. And this is certainly one of them for me. So what's a typical day?
So typical day. Realistically, seeing outpatients. We do some work with inpatients, but typically we are doing certain respiratory tests, depending on whatever the doctors, the surgeons at times have requested. I can go into detail in those respiratory tests if you want me to, but basically it's you'd be doing 45 minutes, anywhere between 20 minutes to 2 hour appointment times with them, going through different tests, making sure that the tests are accurate. That is what I'd say my main job is at the moment. Making sure that what I am giving to the doctors is what they're looking for, two, it's accurate, and then three, it's reliable.
Right. And the doctors order these tests on a day-to-day basis, and then...
So do you want me to go into the tests in depth? Because I can do, I'm more than happy to.
Yeah, why not? Yeah.
Fine. That's absolutely fine. So the main three that I'd say that everybody will pretty much do, all the patients will do, is spirometry, which looks at the caliber of the airways, how efficiently is the air getting in and out of the lungs, and it can tell us whether they have an obstructive or restrictive disease, respiratory disease. Somebody comes in with COPD, you get them to do spirometry, all of a sudden it's chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. You're expecting to see a certain pattern on the tests that you do that looks obstructive, basically.
Okay.
Then you get something like ILD, interstitial lung disease, which is something that's stopping the lungs expanding as much as they should be. That's going to be restrictive.
Right.
Basically. Right. So you're going to look at a restrictive pattern. Again, I could go into all the detail, but there's just no need in this video. I don't think that that's something that really needs to happen. The next test I'd say is called the gas transfer test.
Okay.
This looks to see how efficiently the oxygen is getting through the alveoli, those little sacs in the lungs, into the bloodstream. It's quite clever. It uses carbon monoxide as a replacement for oxygen. And it's actually a very interesting test. Again, I can go into more detail into it if people want, of course. And then the last test, I'd say, the last main test, there are other ones. The last main test is then going to be called lung volumes, or a few different ways that you can do about it. But the gold standard for lung volumes is called body plethysmography. And that just looks at the total size of the lungs, the functional residual capacity of the lungs, which is the point at which you start to breathe in again. So the way that it works is you breathe out, then your body relaxes, basically, and your lungs push out to a certain point where the elasticity and the compliance of the lungs equal each other, and then it starts to breathe out again. The muscles kick in, the diaphragm starts to pull down, then the air goes in. Looking at that to see whether it's elevated, to see whether it's down, and also the residual volume, which is the amount of air at the bottom of your lungs that you will never be able to blow out, which just stops your lungs from collapsing, basically. So there always has to be some air in there, otherwise they're going to collapse and they ain't going to open back up, which is bad, people. That is a bad thing. They're the three main tests that we do. We can also do some others that assess muscle function, a reversibility test, which assesses how efficient salbutamol is on the lungs and what sort of impact it has. Very useful for diagnosing asthma. A pheno as well, which also gives a clue about asthma. So there's a lot of tests that we do, but we do. If we get them, we call it a full set, basically.
Right. Okay. Yeah. And would this, so with these kind of tests, would you expect to find these in every hospital, or is Southampton one of the units that's
realistically the majority of hospitals? I think there are a lot of departments. You might have one or two smaller ones that don't necessarily have this department, respiratory physiologist department, but the majority of them, whether they're physiologist led, whether they're nurse led, because it's quite simple just to be able to learn how to do something like spirometry, which is the basic first test that everybody that's referred to the respiratory center will do. They will just do spirometry and just have a look to see what's going on. It's quite easy just to get a nurse to do that, basically. And they'll be able to do it. They'll be able to send it over to the doctor, make sure that the effort looks good, basically.
Okay. Wow. Really interesting. Right. So sounds like a really interesting role. But there's obviously, so for people who maybe would certainly be considering this, maybe they've just come out of college and they want to get exposure to the healthcare system, or maybe they are an undergraduate student who is thinking about graduate medicine or something like this. And again, they just want to get some clinical exposure. What would you say are the pros and cons to this role specifically?
This, just this role, and you need to be a people person for any job in the healthcare setting. You've got to be a people person. You've got to enjoy interacting with people. For this, if you enjoy just chatting, just chatting away, this is actually a fantastic job. And it's one of the favorite parts of my job is that I've got at times 2 hours with one patient. And you've just got that opportunity to get to know them, just to chat with them, find out a little bit about they are. One of the big things that I've been doing, any scuba diver that comes through in my, as my patients, I've been asking them everything about scuba diving, because it's always something that I've wanted to do. I want to get certified. I've been asking them, what would you do? Would you do this? Would you do that? Where would you get certified? And patients absolutely love that sort of human interaction with, they don't feel like they're a test subject, because this is terrifying for patients.
Yeah.
They're coming in a very white clinical room. They're sat in a glass box with times where I'm shutting the door. They might be claustrophobic, they might not be.
Right.
But just being able to chat to them and mm-hmm. just is a for me personally, because I am very much a people person, because I love to chat, that's a huge pro for me. The other one that I'd say is there's another couple of pros. The next one I'd say is it's very interesting and there's so many learning opportunities. If you're interested in not just the respiratory system, but very high-tech equipment and going into like setting it all up, how the nitty-gritty parts of it work, the science behind all of the tests that you're doing, if you find it interesting, if you enjoy that sort of stuff, once again, 100% it will be for you, because there's just so much that you can just latch onto and get stuck into, basically, and just enjoy about the job. The other main pro I would say, especially about respiratory physiology, is there are not a lot of respiratory physiologists out there at all, in the slightest.
Right.
The degree that you do is quite niche. I can't remember what it's actually called, but it's something to do with physiology.
Okay.
And then people get the opportunity to specialize, basically.
Right.
And a lot of people tend to go for cardiology, because arguably it's a little bit more interesting. There's more going on with ECG leads. Got the how it works with the vascular system. So a lot of people go for cardiology, which means there's a big gap at the moment in respiratory physiology, which means there are loads of jobs out there.
Right.
Loads of jobs. Everywhere is employing, basically.
Mm-hmm.
Everywhere. You can go locum, you can get full-time permanent positions. So yeah, it is definitely a fantastic job. So cons-wise, really, I'd say that the issue is I'm not really getting enough responsibility. Influence is a big one. I'm also I don't feel like I follow up enough with patients. I don't get that all of the patient interaction that I'm looking for. So it's wonderful. I get 2 hours to get to know somebody at times, just to be able to have a chat and just hopefully make their days a little bit better, because it makes my day a little bit better too. But then I don't see them after that appointment. It's very rare that I do see them. The one clinic actually that I would get to see is the cystic fibrosis clinic, because they have to come in and do spirometry a lot. And it's only a short appointment, but it's 20 minutes. But you also get to see them improve on medication and just have a chat when they come back. Like, how have you been for the last few months? That sort of stuff, which is quite cool. And I just want more of that, more of those follow-ups, more of that patient interaction.
Yeah.
Being able to see what I'm doing, what my job is doing for other people, for the patients that are coming through, basically.
Yeah.
Which is why, and as I'm sure that we'll go into a little bit more depth, that I'm looking at changing my role, potentially going into graduate medicine, physician's associate, nurse, something along those lines.
Yeah.
So I can have that sort of influence.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's not quite enough for me, but if it's enough for you, because the other thing as well is you've got it's a 9-to-5 role.
Yeah.
And you get in at 9, you get in the office at 9, you go home at 5, and because you're patient-centered, you don't really have any work to take home.
Yeah.
You want your evenings, if you want your weekends just to yourself, you don't have to pull any night shifts.
Yeah.
You don't have to do awful twilight shifts, anything like that. You go in, you see patients, you come home, and if that's what you're looking for, that is 100% what you're looking for, and there's nothing wrong with looking for that. It's just for me personally, it's a bit of a con. I want more. I like to be busy because I'm stupid.
And I think that's a huge thing. I think one of the reasons why I know, particularly for graduate medicine in the UK, when you're applying, they look for you to have depending on what school you go to, a certain amount of experience in healthcare settings. And some schools even, I think, limit the number of experience you can have from one setting, because it definitely is so important to, you know, it's great if you can shadow a doctor or shadow a nurse or, you know, spend a week in a hospital. But then trying out these other roles and seeing what, you know, 100%. All the little roles that make up, for example, in the UK, the NHS, is really important to find what fits for you, because it's all well and good saying you want to do something, but without really understanding how that role, you know, comes together with everything else, you know, it's very easy to, you know, just think that you want to do something for maybe one particular reason and not have that exposure. You know, like in my case, it took me on and off probably a year to really decide what position in the healthcare system I would consider I wanted to do. I knew that was what I wanted to do somewhat through exposure and experience, but ultimately took me, like I say, you know, probably 12 to 18 months to really understand what it was that I wanted to do and why I wanted to do it.
I think that's a very mature thing as well, because obviously I don't know the age of the person that's watching this video right now, but I feel like at a very young age, there's a lot of pressure. The age of 16, 17 to decide what you want to do for the rest of your life. And so happy that I took those 3 years after uni out of doing what I wanted to do, not thinking career-wise. Because now that I've come back, I've used that time, I've matured, and I've thought about what it is that I want to do. And I've had that time and experience to work out myself. You do not need to decide at that age that you want to be a doctor. You don't need to make that decision that you want to go in, that you want to be a nurse. You can take the time, you can work it out. You can take 12 to 18 months to think about it. And I 100% recommend it, because no matter where you are in the healthcare setting, it's always going to be difficult. There's always going to be challenges that you're facing. And if you're not motivated, if it's something that you're just a little bit like, meh about, you won't enjoy it, basically. And if you're not enjoying it, what's the point of doing it?
That's certainly the way I look at it as well. You know, I went into my leaving cert a little bit unsure what I wanted to do. I ended up studying science. And it was only through all the experience that I had probably after those exams that have led me to this. So I had thought about it in my leaving cert, but really didn't have the exposure, didn't have the true understanding of what I would be getting myself into. And now I'm in a situation where, a bit like you, you know, we have friends now who are going out and working full-time jobs. Where this is, you know, for example, if we talk about graduate medicine, this is another 4 years commitment. This is a big financial investment. And, you know, you're definitely going to be, you're not going to be earning probably a lot for the next 4 years, like all your friends and people, you know, and family are. So, but at the same time, knowing with all that in mind, knowing that you still want to do it is a huge thing, because I think it's the making of all that experience that you've had up to this point that really it's very hard to get at the point of leaving cert or A-levels.
100%.
You know? So that leads us neatly on to graduate medicine. Obviously, largely this channel is focused on graduate medicine, the applications, and all that sort of thing. And I actually have a video coming hopefully pretty soon on applying to the UK. UK schools, so hopefully they'll cover all that kind of information.
We'll definitely give that a watch.
I thought about applying. I did actually apply to the UK, but I applied with a UCAT score that was mediocre rather than using my GAMSAT. It was a bit of a mess, but it was good. It was good experience, and it's actually really helped me, especially because now I really understand the, you know, the UK system and how to apply over there, which is great.
Yeah, definitely.
More importantly, you have been recently thinking about graduate medicine. So
yes,
how has this come about, and where are you at in the process now?
So I actually have you to blame for this. well, not just you. Other people have mentioned it to me as well, especially work colleagues. Because it's something that I have broached with people that I'm close to at work, basically. And the whole I'm not getting enough knowledge, responsibility, that sort of stuff. I was told about the physician's associate role by a colleague at work. And I had a look into it. What it would entail, a two-year master's with a lot of hands-on work, which I really enjoy. And my understanding of the role is that it sits somewhere between a nurse and a doctor, basically. Just somewhere in between those two. It takes a lot of pressure off the nurses and off the doctors at the same time. And just taking a little bit of both of their job roles on. I know how overworked, how understaffed they are. And it's just, to me, it's a very nice role that just fits in there, that just takes some of the pressure off these very hardworking individuals.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a few conversations with people about it. You yourself are one of the people that I had a conversation about it with. Because I know that you're obviously going through this process. I was just wondering if, when I called you, I was just wondering if you've heard of it, what your opinions of the role are.
Mm-hmm.
And it was posed to me by two people, at least, probably more.
Yeah.
That said, if you think that you've got what it takes, the aptitude, the ability to learn, the drive to be a physician's associate, where you'll be working very, very, very hard, why don't you think you could be a doctor?
Mm-hmm.
And initially, I'll 100% admit that I just answered anything at that, just any excuse to not have to answer that question properly. Mm-hmm. And it took then a few days for me to process the question and start thinking, like, why don't I think I can do it? Why don't I feel like I've got what it takes? And in the end, I personally, it just came down to my own fear of failure.
Yeah.
Pretty much of, I don't want to say that I wasn't good enough to be a doctor if I try it and I just don't get in. But half the battle, especially for me and my mind, half the battle is just knowing why. Mm-hmm. And now that I know that it's just a fear of failure, I can start to think, well, there's only one way to beat the fear of failure, and that's to try.
Yeah.
Really. And just to give it a go. Like,
mm-hmm.
being a doctor is going to be very difficult. It's going to be very hard. There's no shame in not being able to be a doctor at the end of the day, not making it. And it's just, I've had to coach my way around to that sort of thinking, basically.
Yeah.
And then start thinking about applying myself to it.
Yeah.
You asked where I am in the process.
Yeah.
I'm currently in the process of moving jobs, moving houses.
Mm-hmm.
So there's quite a lot going on.
Yeah.
And I've decided that I'm going to apply for the GAMSAT.
Yeah.
Mainly. Yeah. I'll probably do the UCAT as well, like you did yourself, in March.
Okay.
And the way I'm considering this, the way that I'm thinking about this, is that this GAMSAT is as much as a test for me as it is, well, the results are as much of a, have as much importance for me as they do for the medical schools that I'm applying for. If I don't get the numbers, if I don't get the result that I feel would be good enough to take me into medical school, then it's not for me. And I can accept that. But if I do, that means that I do have the skills and the aptitude and the knowledge and the ability to learn as much as the next person that's passed their GAMSAT. So I'm seeing it as a my right of way into medical school.
Okay.
Is how I'm sort of treating the GAMSAT for myself at the moment. Because it's going to provide me, I know it will provide me that motivation to work hard, to get my head down and just to learn as much as I can, basically.
Yeah.
So that's where I am at the moment.
Yeah.
Just got to get this next, I think I've got a week or two till I'm moved in, my new job started. And then I can start just proper knuckling down and learning as much as I can for it, pretty much.
Yeah. Yeah, no, that, I mean, look, that makes sense, and it's a huge undertaking, as hopefully some of my other videos will have described in some detail as we go along. But it is, particularly the GAMSAT, it's a huge undertaking. People often take it multiple times, and it's you know, it's huge in and of itself. Particularly in the UK, I guess one of the good things that will stand to you is that, you know, and I think something that people have to remember is, you know, experience, and, you know, that there are different elements to your application, like your, you know, personal statement, you know, the interviews if you get there. Yes, of course, your GAMSAT or UCAT will factor in as far as getting an interview is concerned, but
you know, ultimately there is a lot more to it than that. And I think as we've gone through this chat here today, I mean, you definitely highlighted that, you know, a role like yours gives you good exposure, and it, you know, dealing with patients, speaking with patients, all those kind of things that I guess can sometimes easily be forgotten. You know, I think sometimes people have that idea of med school, and that's what I'm trying to focus on as well, to remember that although you're going into graduate medicine where you might be in the books all day, to remember that where you're going to arrive back at is you're dealing with people, and you're dealing with, you know, and to have those strong points like you do. You know, I certainly would see from the outset that, you know, I'm sure those are the kind of skills that are going to make someone a better doctor. It's not just about, you know, how well people necessarily how well people do in their GAMSAT first time round. You know, I know people myself who have taken it 2-3 times, and that may well be the case, but they look like they're going to go on to be great doctors, you know. And again, that's the, you know, that's my judgment, but obviously I'm, you know, at the very beginning of this process, so my assessment only goes so far, you know.
Well, one of the things that I think I've learned in the healthcare setting is talking to the people that aren't doctors, the better doctors tend to be the better at interacting with people, from both a patient and a colleague point of view. I haven't had to deal much with doctors. I get to them occasionally. But from talking to people in the healthcare setting, the ones that just treat everybody with respect and they don't hold put themselves on that pedestal, tend to have a from what I've seen tend to have a better relationship with those that are that do so. They tend to have a better relationship with their colleagues and with their patients. They tend just being able to create that personal connection, which is a lot of people I don't want to say a lot of people, but I think some people won't understand is that human connection from people does absolutely loads in a healthcare setting. It makes treatment so much, one, easier, and two, to be honest, better. A positive frame of mind is huge to trying to heal. Everybody will have experienced it. You've got a cold, you've got that sort of stuff. You can either just sit there in bed and just feel miserable about the day, and it's probably not going to be any better the next day. Or you can just try and switch up your mentality about it. And I know it's not like that for people. And I'm not saying that it's like that for everybody. And I don't, don't want to put that across, but it just helps.
Yeah.
That's all I'm trying to say, basically.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And, you know, it's what the people side of things is one of the reasons why, for me, you know, I've always said to myself, if I didn't get straight into medicine, my plan was going to be, I was going to try and either do something like a paramedics course or something like this, and continue to be able to still carry out, not necessarily the same tasks as a doctor or another healthcare professional, but be involved in that process, looking after people, dealing with people. You know, for a lot of, for a lot of people, you kind of have to see those values is really important as well, that that you you know what the role entails, and you hold on to that no matter what it is. You know, just because people, you don't necessarily have to do graduate medicine to be able to help people and to be able to fulfill those kind of I guess job roles that you would want to, and your role is another example of that. It's a it's a foot in to the healthcare system and something that people should really consider. And as you've said, and I completely agree with people who are maybe, and this maybe goes out to anyone who would be watching this that is maybe at an A-level stage or a leaving cert stage, to remember that these options can be important. And while they might seem a while away, it can be, you know, it could be the best thing that happens to you, that you don't get into medicine at undergraduate, and that experience stands to you.
100%. Yeah, everyone's going to have their own role in the healthcare system, because as I said earlier, every single job in the healthcare has its own challenges. 100%. And there might be similar challenges, there might be completely different challenges, but if you don't have the motivation to overcome them, as I said, you're just not going to enjoy it.
Yeah,
you don't see it in the challenge. If you see it as a brick wall in front of you, it's just going to be, it's going to be difficult.
Absolutely Chunks, it has been a great time chatting to you. I'm really excited that this is the first in hopefully a line of videos talking to people, as I spoke about in my intro video, speaking to people in the healthcare system and, you know, in different countries, different backgrounds. And, you know, respiratory physiologist is certainly something for people to consider and think about. And really nice for me as well to hear about those kind of roles. If anyone, especially if you're in the early stage of graduate medicine and maybe you need to get that experience, maybe you need to, you know, spend some time in the hospital, not for the sake necessarily just of getting the hours done for your application, but also to really expose yourself. It sounds like, it sounds 100%. Like for people that need that exposure, it sounds like a great way to start.
I think that the best thing that you can do is just try and enjoy it, really. If you do get the opportunity to shadow anybody in any healthcare setting, just enjoy being there and watching how everything works and how everything intertwines. It's fascinating. It really is.
Yeah Fantastic. Well, thank you so much.
Pleasure.
Chunks, it's been a pleasure. Great.
Thank you for having me. If you want one in the future, my rate's going up, so you'll have to start paying
more. Well, I'll keep an eye. And you know, listen, if my views go viral because of this, I'll be sure to get you back on immediately.
Yeah, some royalties, please. Been a pleasure.
Thanks a million.
Thank you for having me.
See you later.
See you later. This is getting cut out.
100% getting cut out.
What's the chance if this making
it? Wow. Scrap. Yeah. No, definitely something for me to work on. A personality shit.
Just not being a complete and utter.
You're working away. Respiratory psychologist. So many of us.
Respiratory physiologist, mate.
Okay, let's take that. Take two.
Respiratory psychologist.
Wow. Yeah. So I've been tuning in, you know, really.
Yeah, I feel like a really interesting person right now.
That is shocking. That is really bad. Okay. Prospective journey, I guess. No, let's try that again.
Yeah.
So that leads us neatly on to graduate medicine. So I've obviously
spoken to that one, or do you want to do it again?
I'll try again. Okay.
Okay, hang on. Let's go. You've gone out.
Have I? Are we back?
We're back.
Trunks, it's been. Oops, sorry. Let me try that again. Chunks, it's been absolutely outrageous. No, it hasn't been outrageous. It's been a normal chat. Why would I say it's been outrageous? You know what I mean? These are the kind of things that, you know? Oh my God.